Why do you think it's so difficult to break the habit of obsessive thinking? What if rumination is difficult to kick because we evolved to be ruminators? If you think back to our ancestors millions of years ago, it becomes clear to you that they couldn't exactly afford to just be happy with what they had. They had to constantly be on the lookout for more of what they wanted and less of what they didn't want. And so it would make sense that over time, natural selection would favor the genes for rumination. But we also know that life today is drastically different from life millions of years ago, and many of the issues we face today, luckily, are not existential. By existential, I mean literally a matter of life or death. I know it's not something that's at the forefront of our minds as we navigate our everyday lives. To think about the issues in our lives as fundamentally not existential or not as existential as we believe them to be, but certainly in the context of how far we have come as a species, it becomes clear to us. Now, unfortunately, in an era of liquor stores making a killing and prescription meds for anxiety being given out like hotcakes, we can't exactly afford to wait for our genes to come around. You know, and I know, anybody who's struggled with wanting to turn off our mind knows that one of our biggest issues today is ourselves. So I want to make this video today, and in this video, I want to talk about rumination, what goes on in our brain when we ruminate, and what can we do to stop it. Spoiler alert, I'm going to be singing the praises of meditation, but not before I paint a compelling case for meditation. And so hopefully by the end of this video, if you're not already a regular meditator, you're gonna walk away with some inspiration to pick up the practice. That's gonna be my goal. You can let me know how good I do. Did you know that scientists used to believe that the brain is only active when a person is engaged in a focused activity? When psychiatrist Hansberger, the inventor of EEG, first proposed that the brain is constantly busy, his ideas weren't taken seriously. It wasn't until PET scans were invented that scientists could measure metabolic changes in the brain. And as it turns out, the metabolism of the brain doesn't change all that much when a person goes from a state of rest to being engaged in a focused mental task. This observation is further validated by neurologist Marcus Raichel. In the mid-1990s, he conducted experiments that revealed that the energy consumption of the brain at work is only about 5% greater than that of the brain at rest. In other words, even at rest, the brain is constantly highly active. Anybody who struggled with anxiety knows this, okay? We don't need a study to tell us that. Raichel's discovery at the time, though, was pretty big. In 2001, he coined the term default mode to describe the circuitry of the brain at rest. Since then, research interest in the default mode network has skyrocketed, with particular attention being paid to the relationship between the default mode network and psychiatric conditions like depression and anxiety. When a person is engaged in rumination, their default mode network is said to be overactivated or hyperconnected. This makes sense when you consider what the default mode network actually is. It's a network of brain regions that get activated together when a person is ruminating, when their mind is at rest, when they're not focusing on anything in particular. So what are these regions? For one, there's the anterior medial prefrontal cortex and the posterior cingulate cortex. These are two hubs that facilitate self-referential processing, like thinking about your emotional state or remembering events of the past. Second is the dorsal medial prefrontal cortex subsystem, which plays an important role in the processing of information about other people and inferring what their intentions are. Finally, there's the medial temporal lobe subsystem, which is involved whenever you make a projection about yourself in the future. What do thoughts about your sense of self or your sense of others in relation to yourself have in common? These are all ego-based thoughts. And in psychology, your ego simply refers to your sense of self. This is not to say that all ego-based thoughts are bad. It could just be a matter of moderation. Have you ever noticed, though, that the thoughts that tend to keep you up at night are the ones that are centered around your sense of self? You're not exactly losing sleep over the fact that your favorite football team just lost a regular season game, or at least I hope you're not. The default mode network is negatively correlated with another type of network in the brain. This network is called a task positive network, and it gets activated whenever whenever your attention to your external world is increased. This means that by paying attention to the here and now, you can decrease the level of activity in your default mode network. This is how you find relief from rumination, and it's kind of what the hype of mindfulness meditation is all about. The objective of mindfulness is to simply notice the contents of consciousness. This means noticing the makeup of your external environment, from the sounds that you hear to the sensations that you feel. It also means catching yourself when you drift off into thought and covering those thoughts with your awareness. And somehow, almost like magic, watching them drift away like the clouds of a weather pattern. Meditation is awesome, and it can give you some immediate relief. But even more remarkably, over time, meditation can also change the wiring and makeup of your brain. I want to share a quote with you by Dr. Rick Hansen of the Greater Good Science Center at UC Berkeley. He says, according to him, when neurons fire together, they wire together. Mental activity actually creates new neural structures. What flows through your mind sculpts your brain. Thus, you can use your mind to change your brain for the better. This is why Dr. Hansen refers to meditation as self-directed neuroplasticity. This means that the benefits of meditation can extend far beyond the practice itself. We see in seasoned meditators a reduced level of activity in their default mode network even when they're not meditating. We also see structural changes in the brain, like an enlargement of the prefrontal cortex, which plays a critical role in emotional regulation and rational decision making, a shrinking of the amygdala, which is regarded as the fear center of the brain, a thickening of the hippocampus, which is key for learning and memory. So all good things. But here's the catch. To truly get the benefits of meditation, you have to make a regular practice out of it. It's one thing to do 10 push-ups every time you feel like you've eaten too much bread, but it's another to actually go to the gym 2 to 3 times a week. One session of meditation can certainly make you feel good for a short period of time, but it's not gonna give you the mental pecs that you're looking for. And I know saying this isn't sexy, because after all, we live in a society that would much rather take diet pills over eating right and exercising. But going back to a point that was mentioned earlier about how sometimes the things that are good for us can sometimes feel like they're unnatural. Just imagine describing the concept of working out at the gym to somebody at the turn of the 20th century, somebody who works in a factory as a laborer. They would have looked at you like you're crazy. Similarly, if you were to talk about meditation to people today, you're probably gonna get some reactions along the lines of, I can hardly keep up with everything that I have to do on my to-do list, so you're asking me to take 20 minutes out of my day to do nothing? I feel very strongly that the culture is going to eventually come around, and one day we're gonna see that meditation is just as core to our well-being as brushing our teeth or going to the gym. In the meantime, in an era where the liquor store is making a killing and so are, prescription meds for anxiety, we clearly have a desire to turn off our minds sometimes. So why not? Why not meditate if you don't already meditate regularly? Now that you've made it to the end of the video, let me know how I did. Did I paint a compelling enough case for you? If I didn't, what did I miss? Thanks for joining me for another video. Give this video a like and comment down below, and I will see you guys next time.